morning, folks. My name is David Brown. I'm Chief of Emergency Medicine at Massachusetts General Hospital, and on behalf of Mass General and the founders of Hub, the other founders of Hub Week, Harvard, MIT, and the Boston Globe, I welcome you all to Hub Week 2019. Thank you for being here. The theme of Hub Week in 2019 is the pursuit, and that's where this morning's guests live their professional lives, in pursuit of science, technology, and exploration. Before I introduce our panelists, though, I'd like to recognize students and teachers from the Dearborn STEM Academy, a Boston public school focused on STEM, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. Dearborn STEM Academy serves 400 students from grades 6 through 12 and is an educational partner of Mass General Hospital. The students here today represent the next generation of scientists and explorers, and we're really glad to have you here with us today. 50 years ago this summer, the United States made a historic landing on the moon, and scientists at Harvard and MIT were critical to the success of that mission. Boston's contributions to space exploration have continued to this day. In fact, six members, one half of NASA's astronaut class of 2017, have Massachusetts roots. And I'll also note that last week, on September 25th, another New Englander, NASA class of 2013, and one of Mass General's own researchers, Dr. Jessica Meir, launched to the International Space Station for a six-month mission. This morning, we are privileged to have members of the next generation of space explorers with us for this exciting discussion. These folks do have the right stuff, and I'm honored to introduce them to you this morning. Ariel Ekblah is the founder and director of the MIT Media Lab's Space Exploration Initiative. She leads a team of more than 50 researchers who are actively prototyping our sci-fi space future. Her team is exploring self-assembling space architecture for space tourist habitats in the future and for space stations in orbit around the Earth and eventually around the Moon and even Mars. Michael Johnson is a Smithsonian astrophysicist, a lecturer in the Harvard Department of Astronomy, and an inaugural member of the Harvard Black Hole Initiative. He studies the most compact beings in the objects in the universe, black holes and neutron stars. He uses radio telescopes and imaging at extremely high resolution, and most recently he co-led imaging efforts of the Event Horizon Telescope to produce the first picture of a black hole. NASA astronaut Johnny Kim is a member of the 2017 astronaut candidate class, and at the time of his selection, having received his medical degree here from Harvard Medical School, Dr. Kim was a resident physician in our emergency medicine training program at Mass General, where he and I worked together. Johnny was an extraordinary clinician and an inspiration to all of us, students, trainees, faculty, and staff. Prior to attending college and medical school, Johnny served as a Navy SEAL, completing more than 100 missions and earning a Silver Star and a Bronze Star with a Combat V. Johnny, you are an inspiration to so many of us, but I feel lucky to count you and your family as among my closest friends. Welcome back to Boston. And finally, our moderator, Carl Zimmer, an award-winning science writer and columnist for the New York Times. Carl is the author of more than 13 books about science, and I just downloaded his latest book to my phone, which is She Has Her Mother's Laugh, The Powers, Perversions, and Potential of Heredity. He's also the only science writer to have a species of tapeworm named after him, and I'm sure there's a story there. To get us all off the ground and in the right mindset, we have a special greeting from astronaut Jessica Meir.
Greetings from Star City, home of the Cosmonaut Training Center outside of Moscow, Russia. I'm Dr. Jessica Meir, and as I record this greeting, I'm preparing for a six-month mission aboard the International Space Station. Our launch is September 25th, just 21 days from now. We'll be traveling to the Baikonur Cosmodrome in Kazakhstan in a few days to prepare for launch. And guess what? An MDH flag was recently launched and awaits my arrival in space. Stay tuned for those images and for that flag to eventually make its way back to you. I am beyond excited for my mission to contribute as a subject and operator in a diversity of scientific studies, to conduct spacewalks, and to operate, maintain, and repair various systems on board the space station. We are investigating questions ranging from why arteries of astronauts are stiffening and thickening at a rapidly accelerated rate while in space, to how combustion processes can be improved for better fuel efficiency here on Earth and for future long-duration space travel. I grew up in Maine, and since the age of 5, I knew I wanted to be an astronaut. Throughout my life, I involved myself in as many space-related activities as possible. My favorite subject, though, was biology, and that passion led to a career studying the physiology of animals in extreme environments. As a researcher at MGH, I was fortunate to work with Dr. Warren Zabel, Chief Emeritus of the Department of Anesthesia, who I consider an important mentor. We share a common interest in the physiology of deep diving seals and penguins, particularly in remote locations like the Antarctic. In pondering another extreme, I also studied bar-headed geese, the remarkable species that migrates over the tallest mountains on the planet each year. These research experiences provided an ideal background for my NASA training. Now I'll learn firsthand how to function in space, with microgravity, temperature extremes, and lack of atmosphere outside the hatch. And after all of the research I've conducted, perhaps it's only fitting that now it's my turn to serve as a subject, being poked and prodded for the advancement of science and medicine. I'm honored to be part of the 2013 NASA astronaut class. I'm thrilled to help push the boundaries of space exploration as we look toward new destinations in our solar system. Right now, NASA's Artemis program is preparing to return people to the moon, and then eventually on to Mars. Thanks for letting me pop in to say hello and be part of Hub Week. If you want some information about the International Space Station, this particular mission, or the exciting future space plans, check out www.nasa.gov. Thank you.
Morning, everyone. Thank you all for coming. We've got a pretty amazing panel. We're going to be talking about everything from, you know, the most extreme things in the universe to, you know, the future of humanity. So we need to get started. I thought I'd talk a bit with each of the panelists just to, so you could get to know kind of the kinds of work that they're doing. And then we'll have a general conversation, and then we'll be opening it up for questions. So Michael, maybe we could start with you. So you work with, you study black holes. And so just give us a quick reminder of what exactly a black hole is.
Sure. So black holes didn't exist until the early 1900s when Albert Einstein came up with his theory of gravity. And in this theory, what happens is that when you squeeze material down small enough, the gravitational strength of that material becomes stronger and stronger. And if you make it small enough, then it gets completely trapped. Anything that falls into this black hole then can't get out. And what's so extraordinary about them is that even light can't get out. And so that's why they're called black holes, that we expect them to be these completely dark objects where if you fall in, there's no hope of ever telling anyone, you know, sending any signals, escaping or anything. They contain everything.
And so you and a number of colleagues have seen one. I mean, if they're black, and they absorb all light, I'm not sure how you see them. So maybe you could explain how you actually got to see one.
That's right.
So probably should talk into the mic for the sound.
Okay. So the extraordinary thing about black holes is, you know, they were first this theoretical curiosity, and over the course of the 20th century, we gradually came to the realization that maybe they exist in nature. These are real things, and they live at the centers of galaxies. And so there's this prediction that at the center of every galaxy, there's a huge, enormous black hole.
When you say enormous, like how enormous?
So if you take something like the mass, like our sun, these black holes in galaxies are a million or a billion times bigger than our sun. These are absolute monsters. And the expectation is that they'll be sitting in this bath of hot plasma that's heated to maybe 10 billion degrees. And as they sit there, this plasma is falling into them. It's glowing. And it's lighting up. So the centers of galaxies can actually outshine all the stars in the galaxies. But the black hole is sitting there and is blocking some of that light. So the expectation was that maybe you would see this shadow of a black hole in the center of the galaxies. You can't see anything coming from it, but you can see it blocking the stuff behind it. So this here, this is the first image of a black hole ever made. This is with the Event Horizon Telescope. You know, this isn't a simulation or a cartoon or a drawing. This is an actual picture. And that hole in the center of the donut there, that's where a black hole is living in this galaxy that we looked at. Now, to give you a sense of just how absurd this is, if you take the Earth and you wanted to make the Earth into a black hole, you'd have to squeeze it down to something about an inch across. You could hold it on your finger. This black hole is so big that it would actually engulf our entire solar system. So this black hole has about 6 billion times as much mass as the sun. But the other kind of absurd thing about it is if you take this donut and you look at it on the sky, it's actually about the same size as a donut sitting on the moon or an atom held at arm's length. So to take this picture required creating a new type of telescope. We can't use things like the Hubble Space Telescope. You really have to pursue an entirely different way of creating images.
So do you actually build new telescopes or you just use them in new ways?
Both. So what we did to start out with is we realized that to create this telescope, we'd have to join telescopes all over the world and sort of synthesize an Earth-sized telescope. And to do that, it was convenient. There were already telescopes all over the world that were observing in their own right. But what we had to do is we had to add the equipment that linked them together to work, you know, in harmony as a single instrument. But what we want to do next is build additional telescopes, maybe even in space, and that'll create an even bigger telescope, so we'll get sharper images of a black hole. So, you know, we don't think that a black hole really looks like this blurry thing on the sky. That's because we're pushing our instrument to its absolute breaking point. What we think it might look like is on the next slide, this slide two. So here, you know, you see all this sharp detail. This is a simulated image now of a black hole, where we actually can, on a computer, simulate the material falling into the black hole and getting stretched and sheared apart as it's coming close to this event horizon, the point of no return.
And the color is just reflecting like the temperature of it, or what?
That's exactly right. So in these pictures, the color isn't anything like color you see with your eyes. You know, for us, there is no color. It's just how much radiation is coming from each point on the image, and we color it because it's pretty.
Yeah, it is pretty. So someday we might see pictures like this.
This is the hope. The hope is that what's so exciting to me is that, you know, we see this blurry image, and that tells us this is just the beginning, right? We found our object. We know exactly what we have to do to study it and to make these sharp images. And these objects that, you know, throughout the 20th century, there was no argument for why black holes shouldn't exist, except, well, of course they don't exist. You know, surely some new law of nature will come into play. Something will prevent these absurd things from forming. And what we know now is that's not true. These extraordinary objects do exist, and they're there, and we can study them. Yeah.
Cool. And was there like a moment where you all sort of said, aha, we've got it, or?
There was. So it turns out to make an image with this type of telescope is very difficult. And there are a lot of cases where you might be worried that you're injecting human bias into it. You know, any scientific process, there's the chance that you're fooling yourself, right? You're only looking at the data in a particular way or using particular algorithms that give you the result you were expecting. So what we did is we split our team into four separate teams. And we gave the data to each of them and we said, you're not allowed to talk to each other. So we kept it completely blind. And then after 7 weeks of working on the data completely independently, we all came together for this moment where we're going to compare and see, did everyone get the same answer, or are there all these uncertainties and we all just made different choices? So we unveiled these images in July of last year. And every single one of these four teams had the same donut on the sky. And that's when we knew we had it. This is the moment. This is a black hole.
That's great. That's great. So Ariel, when we go to see science fiction movies and there are, you know, cities on other planets or, you know, giant space stations and so on, I always just think of those as being like, you know, cute CGI things. But you actually like work on that stuff as a job. Like you think and work on building space cities and whatnot. I mean, how does one end up doing that?
That's a great question. We do indeed try to think about the future of human life in space. And one of the ways that we like to frame this is if Elon Musk and SpaceX, who I'm sure many of you know, or Jeff Bezos and Blue Origin or NASA are working on the rockets to get us there, wherever there may be, Mars, Moon, or beyond, we are working on the human lived experience of space. So the photo that you're seeing now is an artist's render, but it's depicting 14 different experiments and projects that we are actually actively developing at MIT to provide the richness of the human experience that most of us expect when we're here day to day on the surface of the Earth. How do we make these aspects of the human experience robust enough to work in space? So the first point to Carl's question is habitats. How do we self-assemble or build habitats that are large enough to really house more than just, say, 6 astronauts in space, which is the amazing, amazing capability that we have right now, thanks to the International Space Station. But to move beyond that, we're thinking of interesting new paradigms for architecture. You can imagine Legos. Everybody knows Legos, right? Everybody knows Legos. Add sensing and some really interesting computing and some power inside of those Legos. Add some powerful magnets on the edges. Toss them up into microgravity and let them self-assemble and build something much bigger than what could have, say, been launched in a rocket. And someday, we actually would love to self-assemble the large telescopes that you might want with a larger aperture to take another photo of a black hole.
So how big are these structures, at least as you envision them? I mean, what should we be thinking of?
So like any good scientific rigorous process as MIT, we start small and we try to grow bigger. So right now the joke is the early prototypes for these are space habitats for hamsters, because the first prototypes were about this big. We were just testing the mechanism of those Legos. Now we're working on a habitat that's going to be about 30 feet in diameter, so almost half of this tent. Imagine a huge sphere. We like to call it a buckyball. It's a shape that's inspired by an architect, also a shape in science. There's a wonderful story there about the communication between science and architects. And then eventually, if we want to realize that vision of science fiction from Jerry O'Neill and Isaac Asimov and others, we're looking at how do you scale this to have entire colonies of humans. We're not at that point in our research yet. Science is a process. But right now, we're at that middle point thinking about the feasibility of small, you know, scale, but habitats larger than what we currently have on the International Space Station.
And, like, how many people would be living on these sorts of things? I mean, realistically.
One of the beauties of self-assembling space architecture is that it's modular. So you can not only self-assemble one dome or one sphere, but then stack these modules on top of each other and allow the possibility of a modular, expansive megastructure, something that could ultimately house maybe in the hundreds. Right now, we're thinking for a dome, you know, around the size of this tent, maybe a crew of 10, maybe a crew of 15. This could be something that becomes the basis for space hotels, for space tourism. When we get to a point where the technology is robust enough to safely send those of us who are not trained as well as Mr. Johnny Kim is, or is actively in training, to send the rest of us and be able to have a broader population in space.
Do you think this is going to be entirely sort of a public undertaking? Or, I mean, we read so much about, you know, what's going on in the private side of things with Bezos and Elon Musk and others. Like, what do you envision for this?
So I think the answer is both. The private investment that we see in space is absolutely fantastic. It's not just Bezos and Musk. There are many others that are involved in this ecosystem. The public part, the NASA-funded part, the ESA, which is European Space Agency-funded part, is also critical. And what a lot of people don't know is what's actually making SpaceX successful is NASA grants and contracts. What's making Blue Origin successful is a big US Air Force grant, among many other innovative approaches. And so the answer is that we need both of these things to have the public and the private funding to be able to have a really robust ecosystem that will get us out into space, to the moon, and maybe to a Mars colony. One of the questions I often get asked is, we made it to the moon in the 1970s, right? Actually 1969, 50 years to this year. Why didn't we immediately see moon colonies and habitation and this sci-fi vision? Well, part of it is these technologies were in many ways developed before their time. We made incredible progress in the 60s and 70s, in part due to the Cold War, but we didn't have the private part. We didn't have the commercial ecosystem to sustain that kind of involvement in space for all of the rest of us who might like to get involved. And I think now we do. We're at that cusp again.
So Johnny, I have to ask, like, what's it like, you know, preparing to be an astronaut? I mean, like, you're about to, you know, actually go to space. What tell us what that's like.
it's a wonderful opportunity. Every day, you know, I often get asked, what is a standard day for an astronaut trainee or for an astronaut? And I'd have to say there is no standard day. At times, I feel like a grad student studying on the weekends about the space station or about a particular flight we're about to go on or a spacewalk mission that we are planning for. At other times, we're flying high-performance jets to put ourselves in operational positions where our lives depend on the actions that we take at real time. At other times, I feel like I'm doing a marathon in the NutriBuoyancy Lab, which is one of the largest pools in our country that houses the entire space station in a one-to-one ratio underwater. And that is our way of replicating a zero-gravity environment on Earth. And at hour six, you're underwater, and you're on the space station, and you're charged with replacing this critical battery that's been broken down, and you're just smoked, just tired. So that's when you fall onto your physical training. We do a lot of physical training, are held to high standards to maintain that physical training. So I, long-winded answer to saying I feel like a student at times, and I feel like I'm like I'm back sometimes in a military operation.
Yeah, I was just sort of wondering how it compares to, you know, your other experiences as a doctor, as being in the military. I mean, is it a walk in the park? Is it harder or somewhere in between?
I would say that it's a challenge every day in a different way. Certainly, academically, we are always learning. There are so many things to learn about being an astronaut, and it's not possible to be a master in every one of them. Learning high level or the basics and having that ground support where you have the subject matter experts to rely on. I would say that a lot of my experiences from medicine and from the military have taught me the value of collaboration. As Michael has mentioned, you know, collaborating all these different telescopes to complete a mission objective of getting a picture of a black hole. So there are a lot of aspects that I feel I have to use every day, soft skills learned from the emergency department where I'm having to talk to various patients about their illnesses, and the hard skills I've learned in the military of pushing beyond what you think your body is capable of doing.
And so what does the future look like? Are you actually slated for a particular mission, or do you go on sort of a list and you just wait for the call and you find out what you'll be doing? What does the future hold for you?
So our class of 2017 astronauts are slated to graduate here in a month or two. And at that time, we will be active astronauts eligible for space flight. And we have some big missions coming up on the horizon. Certainly we have our space station, which one of our own, Jessica Meir, just launched to last week, and supporting ongoing research missions for that. We also have a directorate to reach the moon, to go back to the moon by 2024, as part of a broader strategy to get from the moon to Mars. So those are probably the big projects coming up on the horizon for us.
Right. So, I mean, everything that we've been talking about is it's a lot of work. It's a huge undertaking. There's an incredibly complex technology we're talking about. And it's all about, you know, getting into space, building space telescopes, space habitations, just living in space, doing experiments in space. Like, why, for each of you, like, why are we doing this? What's the value to this? Some critics will say, oh, space is just a jobs program. Why? What do you see as, each of you personally, what is the importance of it? Maybe, Michael, you want to start?
Yeah, I think this is really interesting for the Event Horizon Telescope project, because in a lot of science projects, the goal is very precise. You know, we want to measure something. And for me to explain why, you would have to have a PhD to even care, right? What's really special about the black hole image is, I think what's inspiring about it to all of you and to us panelists is very similar, right? As to people who have studied it their whole lives, like we're driven by this exploration, you know, this desire to see the unknown and to study things in new ways and understand the universe in ways that were thought to be absurd only a few decades ago. So to me, it's just that drive for understanding, this insatiable human curiosity. You know, this is just part of who we are as a civilization, and you know, it is there. We must explore.
And just to follow up a bit, because Ariel touched on this, but for astronomers like you, getting telescopes up into space is actually a valuable thing. I mean, can you talk about why? You know, you're able to see black holes from the ground. So why do you want to explore building incredibly complex things in space?
Yeah, so basically from the ground, the biggest telescope you make is the size of the Earth. And that's not big enough. We want to go bigger.
Bigger than the Earth?
Bigger than the Earth. So
how's that work?
If we add satellites.
I don't think Ariel is ready to build you something bigger than the
Earth. I know, Ariel's like taking notes. And yeah, no, we're gonna talk afterward. No, so
Johnny doesn't want to fix it. That's too much work.
So the idea is basically for this type of telescope, the resolution you get, how sharp you can make your image, depends on how far apart you can put your telescopes. So if we put a telescope on the moon and connect it, that improves our resolution by a factor of 30. So I mean, then we go high def, right? It's a totally different view into what's driving a black hole. And these black holes evolve on timescales of days. You know, most things in astronomy, we sit and observe them for decades, and they're very dull. Black holes, we can see live and breathe before our eyes. We could study these things in real time. The other thing that kills us on the Earth, as anyone who does optical astronomy knows, is the atmosphere. And so this is actually, we pushed to basically the highest resolution that we can possibly get from the Earth for a lot of different reasons, the size of the Earth, the atmosphere. And, for us as astronomers, as we just push to higher and higher resolution, space is inevitable.
What about you guys? Yeah.
That's why when we talk about self-assembly, this is why it really can be important, and there's an opportunity for crossover here to be able to self-assemble parts of a gigantic structure at the distances that Michael may need in someday. My answer for why do we do space, everything from why do we ask for your taxpayer dollars, but even more importantly, why do we ask for your attention and your imagination? I try to answer it in two different ways depending on your approach to life. There is the philosophical way, and I think I absolutely share what Michael says, which is it's something about the fundamental pursuit of knowledge, the beauty of exploration and finding that final frontier, if anybody knows that reference from Star Trek. And fundamentally what that gives you, especially when you remove yourself from Earth and you have maybe that perspective of that moment when you look back, the overview effect, as many of us have heard, this opportunity is presented to expand our circles of awareness, to understand a little bit more about what it means to be us on this special bastion of life in a really big and grand, beautiful cosmos. So I think there's a philosophical benefit to that kind of perspective shift and understanding our role in the universe. On the practical side, there's also a fantastic history of NASA spinoffs and other spinoffs from space technology coming down to very practically benefit life on Earth. So LASIK, if any of you have had eye surgery, some of those motions and the fine tuning for the laser systems come from docking maneuvers that were developed for the International Space Station. Velcro, microwaves, Kevlar, right? The list goes on and on. And this is where it's more than just a jobs program. There's something about the rigors of designing for space, a very resource-constrained environment, where we then get a lot of benefits when we take these technologies back on Earth, which can be itself a resource-constrained environment for many communities. So that's how we kind of think about both sides. And maybe after we hear the answer from Johnny on his perspective about this as well, I'd love to show the video, and you guys can see what I mean by some of these prototypes that we build that might benefit your life as well as space.
Great, yeah. And just, Johnny, what are your thoughts?
So we have a plaque in our office, in the astronaut office, and it goes something along the lines of, we venture into deep space for the benefit of humankind. And that is the key, for the benefit of humankind. There are many reasons why I think going to space is a great idea, and a lot of those benefits are hard to realize immediately. If you look back at Apollo, we're still talking about that 50 years later. It is amazing that we were able to reach the surface of the moon with technology. All of you have a computer in your pocket that is orders of magnitude stronger than the computer in the lunar lander that got us to the moon. And you can go on how Apollo played a factor in establishing American preeminence in science and technology, and go on to see all the downstream effects that happened for us. But space is, you talked about the overview effect. Our Earth is very fragile, and you talk to people who have gone to space, and they talk about the fragility of our Earth, that super thin atmosphere, and how beautiful our planet is and what we must do to take care of it. I think space also unifies our species in a way that politics, in a lot of ways, cannot do. You talked to Michael Collins, who was on the Apollo 11 crew with Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin, and he will talk to you about how, when they traveled the world, what he heard was, we did it. We got to the moon. It wasn't, you Americans did a great job, it's we did it together. And I think that's pretty special. I think that is a way we can help unify our differences, our species, because from space you don't see borders, you just see a fragile, beautiful planet that we must all take care of.
Great, thank you, Johnny. Thank you. So before we take some questions, so Ariel mentioned that we have a video. Do you want to set it up at all? Or
yes, so if you guys can play the video and turn the volume down, I'll talk over it a little bit just to make concrete what we mean when we're saying we're building the artifacts of our sci-fi space future. So if you guys can cue the video.
So this is the one after slide 8.
Mm-hmm. So every year, we charter a parabolic plane. What that means is it's a normal plane, just like what you'd fly in over the Atlantic.
Here we go.
But it pitches really steeply upward at 45 degrees, and then does what you'd want a plane never to do, pitches really steeply downward, and that parabolic arc gives you this. Moments when we're floating in microgravity, able to test our experiments before they say one day go up and are used by Johnny Kim or used by space tourists in the future. This is a musical instrument that can only be played in microgravity. This is a test for mobility in microgravity. If you're stuck in the middle of the space station, how do you propel yourself forward? This is an outreach program. We had 200 students, like the students yourselves sitting right here, send a project up to be played. That is Michael's wife, who you just saw there, working on physiology sensors for health tracking and physiology tracking in zero G. This is an experiment looking at the future of humans and robots. How will we work together? This is a miniature experiment. How can we do neuroscience on the International Space Station? How can we miniaturize the different levels of inquiry that we're interested in to actually be able to be operated? This is an air-actuated sleeping bag that can provide a sense of embrace for astronauts. This is 3D printing. UV curing resin in microgravity. This poor fellow had an interesting time, a little bit disorienting, a VR headset navigating a maze while transiting in microgravity for space situational awareness. Looking at the sense of Earth and art projects, yes, we do science and engineering, but art is important too. This is looking at surface tension and how water grips to different materials. And this is, several years ago, my first prototype of a self-assembling system to make a small-scale habitat.
So those plates just snap together.
Exactly.
Oh, and DNA.
And DNA. We're looking at early detection of life. How would we sequence life if we found it on the surface of Mars? And that's the team, because although you're seeing each of us up here, we represent huge efforts and a lot of collaborative expertise behind all of us. So thank you.
Great.
For the chance.
Thank you.
For that.
So we have some folks with microphones, I believe. Yes, waving in the back. So if you could put your hand up, we'll try to get to people. So you know, we've thrown a lot of stuff at you. So if you have questions about black holes or, you know, flaming meteors or what it's like to be in a vomit comet, ask away. Yes.
Yeah, thank you. So this goes for all three of you. And as your day-to-day is so mentally and physically challenging, what motivates you to wake up every morning and overcome these challenges?
I can start that off. So I feel incredibly privileged and honored to be standing on stage here in front of you all. I didn't go to college after high school. I enlisted in the military, and all I wanted to do was be a SEAL. And through some very formative experiences, I came to really prize, to really value human life. And I lost a lot of good friends who I think would have contributed a lot of good to this earth. And I made a promise that I would spend my life to contribute in some positive way. And for me, I thought that platform was medicine, and it's something that I wanted, was very passionate about doing. But when I had the opportunity to apply for the, to be a NASA astronaut, I thought of that as being in the same vein of having a platform to contribute something good. So when I see you all, your high school students here, going to the STEM fields, I think that's amazing. I didn't see myself as a physician or as an astronaut. That is the last thing I think I thought of myself. I did not have the highest confidence level. So when I get up every day, what motivates me is having the opportunity to leave a lasting impact on the next generation and being able to contribute something good. And I think the long game is, that's what it's for me.
I also just want to say thank you, Johnny, for your service. My story probably starts with the fact that my parents were both in the Air Force. My dad was an A-10 fighter pilot, and my mom was one of the first women in the Air Force, period. And what they really inculcated in us as children is this service model of leadership, what it means to serve your country, what it means to serve a purpose larger than yourself. And so when we founded the Space Exploration Initiative, the mission from the very beginning was, how do we democratize access to space? How do we build prototypes that maybe wouldn't traditionally be funded by NASA? How do we give experiences to artists and biologists and architects, people that are not just aerospace engineers or technical by training, to get a taste of what space is like? How do we enable space tourism someday and share this experience with more people? And so what motivates me each day is that sense of service, the Space Initiative in service of humankind, trying to explore for the benefit of humankind, and how do we actually make that real? There's so much work to be done that I think I'm motivated simply by the need to keep working at it, to make this my life's work and to continue progressing. And to also speak to the students that are here, you are the next generation. We want to empower you to take part in the future of space exploration, whether you're the ones building the technologies or flying the technologies to space or living in space and being the vanguard. So it's really important to us that we're serving all of these different communities.
How about you, Michael?
I got nothing. I can't compete with this.
No pressure.
I mean, I was a geek, you know. In high school, I just loved puzzles and riddles and tinkering with stuff and just this pursuit of understanding, right? You know, these problems that come up, you know, mathematical problems or new types of research problems, they're like thorns in my brain, you know, there's just this drive for understanding. And I think the remarkable thing is the day-to-day work I do now is very similar to high school, you know, scribbling down solutions to problems and trying to make sense of all these different fields that are so overwhelmingly different. You know, there's just so much to know. But for me, yeah, it's just the drive is, Well, it's twofold. You know, one, it's trying to understand these exquisite systems and this thought that, you know, maybe you can have an idea that opens up an entirely new field of study that no one ever thought of before. It's not impossible, right? There are so many things still to be learned. And the second is that it's really a social experience, this learning. It's not that you go and work by yourself and then solve a problem and then you're done. It's about human understanding, right? Developing an understanding and teaching it to your peers and talking to all of you and people who have never studied it before. I think it's this wonderful feedback loop that makes this this scientific process so rewarding.
Got a question in the front.
I'm just curious, particularly for you, but all of you, what's one thing you really want to learn about that you, through your research, what's one question that you really have that you would like to get some insight on?
Michael, why don't you start?
Okay, I'll give you, this one's sort of technical, but I think you'll understand why it's so bizarre. So for a long time, we've known that black holes, they swallow stuff, and then that's the end. You can't get anything out. So they're kind of the ultimate endpoint of matter. But a few decades ago, people realized that's not actually quite true. If a black hole is spinning, it's actually possible to slow it down. And that sounds like maybe just some intellectual curiosity. But it turns out that if a black hole is spinning, you can extract about a third of its energy from slowing down the spinning black hole. So for this black hole I showed you before, that would be enough energy to power a billion suns for the age of the universe. This is much more efficient than even things like nuclear fusion. And so I see it as a huge unsolved problem in astronomy and physics. Like, can we witness energy extraction from black holes? We now think that black holes are actually, it's not that they're the end sink of everything in a galaxy. They're the energy source for it. They're the engines in galaxies. And so I think it's a huge open problem in physics. Can we find some way of actually witnessing this energy extraction from a black hole? And I think that would be wonderful if we could find some way of studying that with images.
Yeah. Plus one for that. The one that I think captivates me the most is the search for life. And we do this across many different scales right now. I think you've heard me talk about how important democratizing access to space is among our own, you know, set of human life here on Earth. But what if we could have an understanding of, is there life in the universe? If so, where? If so, how did it evolve? Is it carbon and water-based life like ours? Or is it astrobiology with different types of extremophiles that looks entirely different? There are two experiments that we're supporting on our next parabolic flight. So the zero-G flight that you guys saw, our next one is in May 2020. One is looking at a life detection experiment. So if we were on the surface of Mars with a human crew, maybe Johnny, or some of his colleagues in a few years, in a decade, and we were to find candidates that we thought were life, could we sequence them? Could we study their DNA right there with an experiment that actually works? And then the second project that we're supporting is, can we learn a little bit more about abiotic chemistry and the early chemistry that enabled life to evolve on the Earth? And maybe that helps us understand what are candidate planets with the right geochemistry elsewhere in the universe that might be candidates for life having been able to evolve in a comparable way. And some of the fantastic research that's done at MIT right now is around exoplanets. So searching for planets that are in the quote-unquote Goldilocks zone, that are far enough away from their sun that they're not burning up, and that they're close enough that they're warm enough, much like Earth. And while right now we don't have the tools to be able to know for sure whether there's life there, they're at least candidate options. So that would be mine, search for life.
Okay, and I invite any questions from our students here, by the way, right there. Great, thank you.
About the MIT designing thing, and I'm thinking...
Can you talk into the mic so we can hear you?
Yes.
Thanks.
About the MIT thing, and I'm thinking, how do you design something with the artificial gravity, something that spins,
yeah,
but can keep you on the ground?
That is a fantastic question. One of the big challenges that we look at is how can we keep astronauts' bodies healthy when they're in microgravity? And one of the biggest challenges is when you're floating, your body wasn't really evolved to operate in that way, so all kinds of physiological changes that happen. Artificial gravity is a huge and really important aspect to think about in the future of habitats. As you already mentioned, you called out spinning, right? Getting centripetal force is a really good way to get started on that. And I would just say, if you want to work on that with us, when I get off the stage, come talk to me. We do internships. We have students who like to think about design problems, and I'd love to talk more with you guys about that.
Johnny, you want to add something?
Yeah, that is a great question. And as Ariel mentioned, our species has evolved to live in 1x gravity. And guess what? The space station long-duration flights have shown us when you take away gravity, not so good things happen. There's bone density changes. There are fluid shifts. There are neuroocular syndromes that happen. So we don't have any data points between 0 gravity and 1x gravity. And the moon is a perfect testbed for that, being 1/6 gravity. But we don't know, can you negate all these negative effects of 0 gravity by having 1/6? Is it enough? We don't know. We don't have those answers. So I think as we look forward to the moon and bringing the first woman and the next man back to moon to have a sustainable presence, it will be very important for us to investigate what type of changes we undergo with less gravity if we want to make it to Mars.
So going to Mars would involve a long trip, maybe in 0G, maybe you can add some gravity, and then you get to Mars and then you're dealing with it's like a quarter, or what's the gravitational field on Mars? I forget.
About a third,
yeah. So, yeah, I don't know. I mean, is it? I guess we're gonna have to wait and see if a little gravity is enough, or you got to go the whole way because we're human. I don't know. We'll see. Great. Question over here. Yes.
Curiosity. Is there like any ethical dilemmas that you wonder about at night sometimes? Because I am very easy to get excited about like the stuff that you're talking about. Yes, let's go, let's push, and that is where I vote. But like as practitioners in this space, like, what sort of things make you wonder? Like, is this the right thing to do, or is this too much or too soon or anything like that?
Absolutely. So a couple things come to mind is, one, look at the history of how we've treated Earth. Not always so great, where I think where many of us are kind of waking up now to the imperative of climate change mitigation and the things that we need to do to keep our Earth healthy. How do we make sure that we don't just automatically translate the same foibles or approaches that humanity has had on Earth as we've evolved and gotten more sophisticated? Can we make sure that we take a more sophisticated, thoughtful, responsible approach to other celestial bodies? One very concrete way that we do that is planetary protection. So when we send a rover to Mars or we send a rover out to Europa, NASA and other people who build that rover sterilize it very carefully to make sure that we're not automatically spreading Earth-based microbes out into the solar system willy-nilly. It's a really important thing to think about. There's also a discussion to be had about the history of colonization on Earth, not something that we tend to be particularly proud of, a lot of really problematic history there. Can we think about a different term or a different framing for the future of space that's not colonizing space? Maybe it's settlement, maybe it's stewardship. We are stewards of our little chunk, our neighborhood of the cosmos, rather than thinking about it strictly in the terms of colonization. There are many really fantastic ethical questions that we try to grapple with. Thanks for the question.
We got time for one more. Right there?
Going back to this question about gravity. I know we've thought of ways to get the simulation of like zero gravity. Have you guys thought of ways to basically add gravity back into a place where there is any, where there isn't any?
Right. So we were talking about like, you know, spinning as a way of sort of increasing gravity. So that's one way, theoretically. I mean, are there? I don't know. I mean, Could you put a black hole in the middle of your space station and create a lot of gravity? I don't know. What else?
Not recommend it.
Not recommend. Okay, but you get all that energy out of it too. It'd be great, right? is there anything other than the science fiction spinning wheel that we can think of for gravity?
I guess theoretically, you can, if you were to accelerate in a direction to have the level of 1x gravity, and then halfway to your destination, turn around, and then accelerate in the opposite direction, slow down. I guess that would be one way. That would require a lot of fuel.
So that would sort of feel like you're sort of sinking into your seat in a car, and that would be
like G's.
Yeah, like a gravitation, like a G, yeah.
But there's also buoyancy, right? You're talking about this underwater space station, right? Is there any possibility that there's some technology that would make that more effective, where you could breathe underwater or use some other fluid?
The fluid example makes me think of something. It's hard to add gravity back into a whole habitat without doing something like spinning it or accelerating it. But if you wanted to essentially have the effect of loading the human body, so have the human body feel like you're having to fight against the force of gravity for the benefit of keeping your muscles strong, keeping your heart strong, there are ways to use magnetic fields that are safe, magnetic fields that are not so strong that they're unsafe for your body. Things like ferrofluids or magnetic boots that you guys may have seen from NASA, that if you were to distribute that over the human body, you'd feel like you were pulled in closer towards a magnet source. So one of our projects actually coming up for the next year is looking at a ferrofluid, that just means magnet fluid basically, suit, that if you were walking through a magnetic field, a weak one, you would feel a certain pull back to the ground.
All right, so magnetic suits and other cool ideas. All right, well, let's give a hand to our panelists. Thank you all for coming.